Well, we're in the last week of a message series called Culture Wars, and we've been reflecting on the fact that within our culture, there are differences of opinions on how things should be, how things should be run, the way things should be taking place. And many times in the disparity of those differences of opinions, sometimes they're extreme opinions. What happens is we end up with fixed positions, and those fixed positions can end up being a conflict. And the conflict often ends up being between the rich and the poor, the haves, the have-nots, between the young and the old, between the Democrats and the Republicans, between capitalists and socialists, between Israel and Hamas, between every imaginable kind of faction, there ends up being some kind of a conflict. And what often happens when there's two schools of thought or two different philosophies, whoever's in charge, they have people that are going to come against them, and they're going to people have ideas of how things should be done. And it was that way in the time of Jesus. This is nothing new. There's been culture wars throughout all of history. When Jesus came to the earth, there was culture wars all around him. There were differences of opinions, and there were different ways that people wanted things to be run. And Jesus came to the earth, and he began to preach a message that was extremely different from anything that they had heard up to this point. He began to preach about a completely different culture. The Bible tells us in Mark, the first chapter, that he came and began to preach the kingdom of God. Began to preach the kingdom of God, and one of the things that we understand in any kind of a kingdom, and we don't really have a great relationship with the notion of kings and kingdoms and queens and kingdoms, because we live in a capitalistic free society. But in the day that Jesus lived in, there was the notion of kings and queens and emperors, and they had authority. Not only did they have authority, in every kingdom, the kingdom had an economy, the way things were run, there was a structure, there were protocols, there was vocabulary that went with all of that. And Jesus came to the earth and he started to say, even in God's kingdom, there's a difference. There is a king, there's ruling authority, there's a different economy, there are protocols, there are vocabulary that goes around that, and there's a way to live in that culture. And many times, the culture of the kingdom of God wars against the kingdom of this earth. And no clearer place is that found than in the Sermon on the Mount. And we've been reading down through that for the last few weeks, Matthew 5 particularly. And in that sermon, it became clear that Jesus was countercultural and the kingdom of heaven wars against the kingdom of earth. He actually started to say that the culture of the kingdom of God is, it's about meekness. It's about humility. It's about being peacemakers, being pure in heart, about turning the other cheek. And he is really clear that the kingdom of God is what he came to preach. In Luke, the fourth chapter and the 43rd verse, he says, I must preach the kingdom of God, not just here, but to other cities, to other locations. It has to be spread out, because it was for this purpose that I was sent, he said, was to preach the kingdom of God. He told his followers, seek first the kingdom of God and the righteousness of the kingdom of God, and everything else that you've been grabbing for and trying to obtain, all of that stuff will be added to you, but it comes through the kingdom of God. He told them you had to have a repentant heart in order to see the kingdom of God. Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. And we know that many times we only see in part, but we know there's still more to be revealed. And then ultimately he had some disciples and he sent them out to preach the kingdom of God. Luke, the ninth chapter and the second verse. He sent his disciples to preach the kingdom of God. They went out throughout the earth, began to preach the gospel. And one such disciple was a man by the name of Saul, who became Paul the apostle. And Paul began to evangelize, and he was preaching the kingdom of God, and he was preaching the message of Christ, and began to start churches. And wherever he started churches, people gathered and they began to come to faith, and they started to live in a different culture than the culture that was around them. And one such place was a place called Corinth. And Corinth was an economy. Corinth was a place where there was a culture that was a very mixed culture. It was a port city, and so consequently, people would come from all over the region around them. They would gather there, and in the middle of all of that, there would be some pushback, there would be arguments, there'd be all different kinds of ideas about what they should be doing, even at Corinth. Corinth was kind of known as being the Las Vegas of their culture that day. That what took place in Corinth stayed in Corinth. It's what they say about Las Vegas, but how many knows it's not exactly true? What takes place in Las Vegas sometimes comes home and ends up in divorce. Come on. Takes place in Las Vegas sometimes comes home and you have to pay off some credit cards because you spent too much time at a slot machine. Come on, preach, Brother Paul. Sometimes you have to come home and you have to get penicillin for whatever took place. Come. But it was known that in Corinth they did stuff and nobody really talked about it. In fact, there was a slogan that it was, "You, if you went there, you became Corinthianized." It was notable that they had a temple to Aphrodite, and there would be 1,000 prostitutes that would come out at night into the streets of Corinth, and they would sell themselves, and the money would go to fund the temple there. It was a crazy town, but yet even within all of that, you might, as you might imagine, there were divisions, there were pushbacks against even the way things were being run. And it's not so different in Corinth than it is in our generation today. It's not so different. They had a culture war just like we have culture wars. In Corinth, there were ethical concerns that were taking place. There were people in the community that were kind of trying to gain power and gain control. They were proud to be Corinthians. They were proud of their Greco-Roman culture, and they wanted that to kind of be preserved, and yet there were other people that were pushing in on it. There were competing religions. There were all kinds of arguments that were taking place, and many times those arguments would go out into the street. There would be people that would want to gain a following, and so they'd stand on the street corners, and they would argue and debate, and they got very skilled in what they had to say, and they would amass followers. I got to thinking, their idea was to kind of get really skilled in their argument and then amass followers. It was basically the social media of the day. Like, let's really get good at arguing in public places and amass followers to our argument. And that seems to be where we are in many places in our generation today. It doesn't seem different from us. And not only was it that way in their community, it was that way at the church. There were ethical concerns inside the church at Corinth. The church was divided. The church was arguing. There was a culture war inside of the church. How do we do this? How do we go about doing this? What's the right way to do this? What's the right way to baptize? Who should be baptizing? Should we sprinkle? Should we immerse? Should we take them out into the parking lot and hose them down? What's the right way for us to do that? They were having some pretty bad arguments about those things. And there were people like, I like doing church this way. I like it the other way. I like this kind of a thing. And there was competitions for power in there. There were arguments of who was right and who wasn't going to be right. I like this preacher better than I like that preacher. I follow this person, you follow that person. And it started to become a competition among preachers. And all of a sudden there's this culture war that's happening inside of this. And Paul, in the middle of that, he shows up to address the division in the church. And as he shows up to address the division in the church, what of all the things that he could talk about, what does he prioritize? Because he could have picked any subject. He could have intelligently dealt with any one of those things that I just talked about and probably the many other things that were taking place. There were a ton of things that he could have dealt with from a biblical perspective. But here's what I want you to know that he talked about. He had heard that there was some arguing taking place, and he had heard from Chloe about some of the things, the personal conflicts that were happening inside of the church. And when he decides he's going to address what is happening at the church, here's what he says. 1 Corinthians, the first chapter and the 18th verse. The message of the cross. Of everything that he could have talked about, of all the debates he could have picked up, of all the things that he could have taken aside on, here's what he says. I'm going to focus on what is the most important thing in the church, and that is the message of the cross. Let me tell you what that actually means. He's saying that that message of the cross is that we have a king, and that king came and died. And I'm sure there were people probably in Corinth who were not Christians. They were like, you had a king? Yes, we had a king, and he died. Most kings, they come and amass power, and they try to gain power. They try to get very powerful, and they defeat everybody around them. What happened to your king? Our king died on a cross, and what we preach is the message of the cross. And let me just tell you today, I'm going to be really clear. If all the things that we could talk about here at Christ Church, of all the things that we could talk about in the church world today, somehow I feel like many times we get off point and we forget that the central theme of the church is the message of the cross. That's it. And here's what he says in verse number 18. The message of the cross is foolishness. Some translations say it's folly. The original Greek word for foolishness actually means it's where we get the word moron. It's moronic. The world looks at this subject and says it's moronic to talk about. It's foolishness to talk about this. But here's what he says. He's trying to tell them that there's a guy that died, and that guy died and rose again, and he is the central theme of any hope in this world. And to the world, that's foolishness. It doesn't make any sense. That first of all, we had a king that died, and we're celebrating that. But one of the things I would be remiss if I didn't stop and say, he didn't just die, he rose again. Come on. And so here's what he says. The message of the cross is foolishness to those that are perishing. Can I just take a moment here and say that we have to be very careful that we forget that those that don't love the message of the cross and those that don't adhere to the message of the cross are perishing. Like, they think they're living. They think it's good, but it's a short-term good. They're actually perishing. But for those of us who are being saved, it is the power of God. It's the power of God. And then he goes on and he says something that is so important. He's like, he said, for those of us who are being saved, it's the power of God. And then he says, I'll destroy the wisdom of the wise and the intelligence of the intelligent. I will frustrate or I will invalidate. Someday they're going to see all the things that they adhered to, all of the things that they fought about, all of those things that they thought were so important. Like, it's foolishness. It doesn't make any sense. I'm going to invalidate all the arguments that they have. They thought all that stuff was so important, but it's not the important stuff. But for those of us who are being saved, it's the power of God. Paul Gardner, in his commentary on 1 Corinthians, says this: it is thus in people's reaction to the king who had died on a cross that God reveals those who are perishing or those who are being saved. Like, it's the defining line. It's the defining line of deciding for us to be able to see who's the ones that are perishing and those that are being saved. He said it's the reaction to the king who died on a cross. Verse number 19 again, for it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and the intelligent of the intelligence I will frustrate. And this is nothing new. In fact, this was a concept. There was a culture war that was taking place even way before the New Testament church, way before Corinth. Back in Isaiah 29, there was something that was taking place with the children of Israel. And the children of Israel had aligned themselves with foreign kings, had aligned themselves with Egypt, because they thought if they aligned themselves with the pagans, they would still be strong. They would still be mighty. And here, this passage is saying this is foolishness to align yourself with cultures and things that cannot save you. Richard Hayes says in his commentary, in Isaiah, it is a judgment oracle. And this passage is based out of Isaiah 29. In Isaiah, it is a judgment oracle against Judah, whose political and religious leaders were trusting in their own wise and realistic plans to protect the kingdom by making a military alliance with Egypt. rather than listening to the word of God of the prophet and listening and trusting in God. And so this is like, I'm sure there were people that were asking then as there are people that are asking now, isn't that the way you do it? Isn't that the way you win? That you make alliances? Isn't that the way you do it? You make alliances and you get powerful. You make alliances with people that you wouldn't necessarily trust. But here's what he said. No, it's not the way we and the culture and the kingdom of God do it. We trust only in the one who died on a cross. It's a different kind of a kingdom. The kind of kingdom that we're in isn't about power alliances. It's not about gaining fame. It's about walking in humility. It's about being peacemakers. It's about turning the other cheek. It's about loving our enemies. It's about washing each other's feet. And that's not the way it looks in the world. And let me just tell you, the world knows what they do, even though that's the system they adhere to. It's just not working. It doesn't work because here's the deal about it is it's passing away. The world system is passing away. It's a temporary system, but what we're doing is we're doing something inside the kingdom of God. And here's what Paul's saying. Stop being a part of the world system. Stop being a part of the world's culture. Let's stop behaving in the church the way the world behaves. Let's not make what's going on out there what we do inside of here. And you might, honestly, like there are so many churches that are have kind of gotten derailed. And I'm going to go ahead and preach a little bit here today because we're 6 months away from an election. And every time an election comes up, it seems to me anymore that there are all kind of forces that come up and like, are we going to address this? Are we going to talk? Are we going to endorse? What are we going to do? And I'm just going to say this to you really clearly here today. We have one message here at Christ Church of Orlando, and that is the cross of Christ. That's it. I got to thinking about this. When the Lord called Moses to go down into Egypt, he didn't tell Moses to go down into Egypt and reform Egypt and try to reform what was taking place, try to reform Pharaoh, just make him better people. He didn't do that. You know what he said? Go down there and tell them they're not of that kingdom. That I have a better thing prepared for them. And they're going to have to come out of that culture. They're going to have to come out of that movement. They're going to have to go to the place where I promised them to be. That's a better life. And many of us, what we start to do is we get saturated with the world that's around us. And we settle in and get really comfortable. But I'm here to tell you today, there's a better kingdom prepared for us. Here's what he says in verse number 21. For since in the wisdom of the world did not know God through wisdom, it pleased God through the folly of what we preach to save those who believe. Can I just talk about this? Man, just let me be real clear. Should you be in your life, should you vote? Yes, it's your civic responsibility to vote. Amen. Is it all right for you to speak up? Yes, you should speak up. But when it comes to this place and when it comes to what we do here, we have one central theme, and that's Christ and Him crucified. Crucified in a grave, and on the third day He rose again. We have one message, and that is Christ on a cross, who is the living Lord of the kingdom of God. That's our message. And so here's what He says. It pleased God that through the folly of what we preach to save those who believe. Make sure that we're telling people about Jesus. I'm going to say this. I know that I'll probably make some people upset through me saying this stuff, but it is possible for us to reform the government of the United States and for our neighbors, our sons and daughters, our parents, the people we love, our coworkers, to still go to hell. It's not about reforming the government. How about this? It's about us preaching the gospel that is the only hope. It's not by earthly power that we're going to win anything. It's not like, it's not about changing our government. It's about allowing people to know that there's a hope that comes only through a Savior. I'm going to go ahead and preach about this. 1 Corinthians, the second chapter, Paul starts to remind us that there's something that's so important about this. He says, "And so it was with me, brothers and sisters, when I came to you, I did not come with the eloquence of human wisdom as I proclaimed to you the testimony about God, for I resolved to know nothing while I was with you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. I came to you in weakness with great fear and trembling." Now listen, Paul was an intelligent man. Paul wrote a lot of the New Testament. Paul was probably one of the most educated men of his society. And here's what he said. He said, "I didn't come here to prove to you how smart I am and how great my arguing was and how great my vocabulary was." Here's what he said. "I came here and I did one thing. I preached the cross, and that's it." Listen to what he says in verse number 4. "My message and my preaching were not with wise and persuasive words, but with the demonstration of the Spirit's power, so that your faith might not rest in human wisdom, but on God's power." And one of the things, and I'm going to say this, I didn't say this in the first service. One of the things that I want God's power to be so prevalent and so obvious in this church and in the lives of this church, so that even when our young people go off to college and they go to other places and there are people who might be even more eloquent and have better vocabulary and be able to argue about belief systems and about philosophies, they'll always remember, "Hey, you can say what you want to, but I saw the demonstration of the power of God." And that's something that will change a person's heart and a life forever. One of the problems with the church is we have a credibility problem. We talk about church and we talk about changed lives, but then we don't live our lives in the power of God. He goes on, and here's what he says in verse number 14. 1 Corinthians 2 says, "But a natural man does not accept the things of the Spirit." He says, "I'm going to preach, and we want to see the demonstration of the Spirit of God. A natural man does not accept the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolish to him, and he cannot understand them because they are spiritually appraised." There's three categories of people that he addresses here. The first one is the natural man. He doesn't understand spiritual things. He has no appreciation for spiritual things. For him, it's just everyday living. It's routine living. It's the mundane. He has no higher sense of values, no higher sense of purpose. He can't even comprehend. The Phillips translation says none of this even makes sense to him. I'll go ahead and preach about this for a second. Those of us who are trying to win arguments on social media and those of us who are trying to win arguments and thinking that our arguing and winning arguing an argument will win anybody to the kingdom of God or transform anybody's life, we've missed the point. That in all of this, he's saying they're natural. They can't even understand what's real. They can't even understand what's true in the kingdom of God because they're natural. Their minds have not been transformed. Many times we look at the people in the world around us and we go, "Man, they're messed up." And the truth is they are messed up. And the reason why they're messed up is because they don't even have the ability to comprehend that there's a different world and a different life. Here's the second category of people. It says the spiritual man. 1 Corinthians, the second chapter in the 15th verse. "He who is spiritual appraises all things, and yet he is appraised by no man, for who has known the mind of the Lord that he should instruct him?" But we have the mind of Christ. The spiritual man has the mind of Christ. He's able to discern. He prays about something. He listens to what the Lord has to say. He hears the nuances of what the Holy Spirit is saying. He has the ability to know that God has a plan and that he's working that plan. He doesn't say in this that those who are believers know more than everybody else. He doesn't say they're smarter, they have a higher IQ. He is simply saying they are capable of discernment and they lean on the Lord for the Lord to lead them and guide them. And here's how they get that guidance. Number one, they go to their knees. The godly man goes to his knees first. James says, if you lack wisdom, ask God. He goes to the Word of God. Psalm 119 says, the word of God is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. The godly man goes to the word of God. He goes to the wise. He asks for godly counsel. And I'm not just talking about anybody. He goes for godly counsel. Some of you are seeking counsel from people. Some of you are seeking counsel from people on your marriage that their marriage is more messed up than yours because they haven't followed the principles of God. Come on, preach, Brother Paul. Go to godly people and let godly people instruct you. And then finally, he goes to the Holy Spirit. He allows the Holy Spirit to lead him and guide him. And that means that, I'm going to full circle, it takes us back to, then we're the light of the world. We're the salt of the earth. Like, we look different because we're of a different kingdom. The natural man, the spiritual man. And here's the third one. And I'd be remiss if we didn't talk about this. 1 Corinthians, the third chapter, and verse number 3 says, brothers and sisters, I could not address you as people who live by the Spirit, but as people who are still carnal or still worldly, because you're mere infants. Like, you've heard the gospel and you've received the gospel, but somewhere in here you didn't grow. You didn't change. You didn't allow your minds to change. You didn't allow the word to instruct you concerning your lifestyle. You didn't allow the word to instruct you concerning your behavior or your humility. You didn't allow the word and the Spirit to instruct you in the way that you should conduct yourself with enemies. You didn't allow the Spirit to instruct you. And so consequently, even though you've been regenerated, you're still babes. You're still immature. It's just carnal. And so consequently, you live in the mentality of the culture of the world. And Paul says, and listen, Paul says, I understand this because there are things that I want to do and I don't end up doing. And I'm in a conflict with myself all the time. The major issue with many people is that what happens is we live selfish lives and we live for ourselves. And we're like, if I'm in a conflict, then it just must be who I am, and I'm just going to stay that way. But here's what he says. I'm going to read this passage, reading in verse number 2, if you have it back there. I gave you milk, not solid food, for you were not ready for it. Indeed, you are still not ready for it. You are still carnal, for since there is jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not worldly? Like, You're fighting about stuff that is just worldly. You're fighting for stuff that is worldly. But God didn't call us to live like that. He didn't call us to be natural, man. He called us into his kingdom. He gave his life. He gave his son on a cross so that we could enter into a kingdom that is so far more excellent than the kingdom of this world. And then what we do is we trade that off and we say, like, I'll just buy back into what the philosophy of the world is. He said, there's a culture war taking place here. For you and me in this room today, there's a culture war taking place. There's a culture war that, yes, like, we can be Christians and still live like the world. And the truth is, he said, you have to be different. I've called you to be different. I've sent my son to sanctify you and transform you so you don't live like you used to live, but you live a victorious and a pure, and like your life looks very different from the world around you. And so here's what he's saying. Don't be immature. If he's called you, if you're a part of the kingdom of God, don't be immature, grow. And how you do that is life in the Spirit. Let the Spirit lead you. Let the Spirit teach you. Let the Spirit instruct you. And how do you do that? Ephesians says, don't be drunk with wine, where is an excess, but be filled with the Spirit. I'm challenging every person here at Christ Church of Orlando. If you call yourself by the name of Christ, desire the things of the Spirit. Be filled with the Spirit. Don't live by the flesh. Don't live by a kingdom that is destroyed, a kingdom that is fading, a kingdom that's going to pass away, but instead buy into something that brings life. Buy into something that brings joy, something that reflects Christ. Be filled with the Spirit. My prayer is that every person in this room that calls Christ Church home will be filled with the Spirit, the presence of God leading you and guiding you. And so I'm going to give you 4 ways to do that. First of all, realize that you need the Spirit. Realize that you need the Spirit of God just to keep you alive. Number 2, repent of your ways. Repent of any ways that you've taken on that has saturated you like the world and it separates you from the kingdom of God. The third thing is release your rights. Like, I've been hurt. People have said stuff, and I'm this is the way I am. I think I deserve to be. Like, he's like, you're not of that mentality anymore. That's the world's culture. Get away from that culture. And then the last thing is receive the power of God. Receive the power of God. Receive the Holy Spirit. And in this room today, I'm going to pray in these next few moments. I'm going to pray for every person in this room that's somewhere in here. The Holy Spirit will identify to you places where your heart, your mind, your spirit has come into conflict with the kingdom of God, and where you've bought back into the world system, and you've bought into, and he's calling you to a higher place. He's calling you to a different dimension today. He's calling you away from self-destruction. He's calling you away from a life that is going to end and it leads to no joy at all. And he's calling you into a life of peace and service and humility, of washing feet, a life where we actually reflect the Spirit and the love of Christ. And so today, I'm going to pray and ask the Lord to give us the fullness of the Spirit for us to discern the life that he has for us. Let me pray with you right now. Dear Heavenly Father, I ask you that in these next few moments, each and every one of us, that there'll be a desire in our hearts for your Spirit. That there'll be a desire in our hearts not to live by the world's culture, not to live by what the world says is working, but instead, that somewhere in here in humility we'll embrace you, we'll embrace your cross, that we'll realize that only life comes from you and hope comes from you. So Lord, I'm asking you, God, today in the name of Jesus, let your Spirit come into this place and let your Spirit come into each and every heart, that we would reflect you and look like you and walk like you and shine like you in this world. And Lord, we declare we can't do it without you. We need your Spirit. We need your power. In the name of Jesus.